My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, today we will think of another value, contentment. Contentment refers to a state of desirelessness. It's the ability to be satisfied with what one has without unnecessary desires or avarice. It does not imply that one does not want to strive to achieve great things or work hard, etc. Contentment cultivates self-discipline and a lifestyle that is devoid of luxury and ease. Contentment negates greediness. It arises from subduing of one's desires. As Sri Buddha says, desire is the root cause of all evils. So contentment aims to overcome desires which are worldly, petty and greedy. A contented mind is the greatest blessing we can enjoy in this world. We know people are not satisfied with what they have. They desire to have more and more and more. Man cannot be contented, cannot be satisfied. For example, when man who walks in the road sees a bicycle, he desires for a bicycle. It's good to have a bicycle. I can reach early. Once he get a bicycle, he will think of a motorcycle and he aspires for this motorcycle and he works for to get that motorcycle. Once he get a motorcycle, he desires for a car. It goes on like this. It's like drinking water from the sea. You know, sea water is salty. Any amount of water you drink, it will never satisfy you. In order to be happy and satisfied with what we have is the key to a peaceful life. Of course, this does not deter anyone from making progress in life. A contented person is never jealous. Contentment prompts one to enjoy one's life without comparing it with that of another. It will not pave way for unhealthy competition. Contented persons will enjoy serenity and peace of mind. Never will we hear complaint or dissatisfaction from contented persons. A contented person is a friend of all. The fewer our wants, the nearer we resemble God. From Dante's book, there is a story. Once a man has got a God's vision and he has given a chance to visit heaven and hell. He was taken to the heights. The angel who took him asked him, "Which one you want to see first?" He thought, "If I see heaven first and then hell, I have to go back the imagery of hell to my home. So I thought of seeing first hell, then heaven." The angel took him to hell. In hell he saw men and women with sunken faces and bony limbs seated around an enormous heap of tasty rice and fruits. All sorts of food. So many people around this food. They were all terribly hungry, but they cannot eat. Why? The hands were tied with long spoons and they could not fold their arms to eat. When they tried to reach the food to the mouth, the food was thrown to the floor. They were thinking of only themselves. Food is there, cannot eat. They have no other choice. They have no other thinking because they are all selfish people. They want all these things, but they never think of others. Whereas in heaven, he saw the same situation. Men and women seated around another heap of rice and fruits, so much of fruit, very similar to that one he had seen in hell. But here, all very, very happy, with beaming faces and aglow with health. They were all eating sumptuously. What happened? They shared their food to the other. They too could not fold their arms while eating, but everyone was thinking of the other, and hence they were feeding the person in front with content and joy. My dear brothers and sisters, if you look in the world, you look in India, we can see the disparity among the people. Around the 20% of the people are very rich. Around 20% very poor. The disparity is so high. Why is this? The middle class people, they are satisfied and they live a healthy, happy life. The 20%, the first 20%, enormous sum of property, money, and all sorts of luxuries they have. Whereas the last 20%, they have nothing, no shelter to live, no clothes to wear, no food to eat, don't have a real human life. They live in slums. Suppose the first 20, if they share their enormous amount of property with this poor, everyone will be contented. Everyone will have enough food to eat, enough clothes to wear, enough shelter to live. Actually, this world is a rich world. God has created a beautiful world. Everyone will have everything in this world, just because some very few, they keep all things for themselves. Imagine what St. Paul tells: if you have something to eat and something to dress and to live, you can be contented. This is a real truth. Whereas what real reality is, so many people are poor. So many people are really living in poverty. Nothing to eat, nothing to wear. Very tragic, terrible life. So if each and everyone is contented in their life, they can support so many people. They can help so many people. In St. Luke chapter 16, we have a beautiful story. The story of the rich man and the poor Lazarus. Rich man is living in so luxurious life, eating such luxurious food, living luxurious apartments and everything in luxury. Very pomp life. Whereas this Lazarus, he is living in his gate, really poor, nothing to eat, the body is full of sore, but this rich man, so many several times see him but never care him. So easily this rich man could help this poor man, this Lazarus, to have a decent life. My dear brothers and sisters, this is real contentment. You be happy with what you have and help others to be happy, to have a contented life. How can we cultivate this contentment? First, enjoy one's life without comparing it with that of another. Second, controlling carefully the use of food, clothing, time, recreation, and everything. Third, desiring and requesting only the basic essentials. Finding time daily for quiet reflection to replenish moral and spiritual resources. Purchasing only essential commodities for simple life. Overcoming the obsessions of foreign goods. Happy with what we have. Yes, let us be happy and content with what we have. God will give everything in full for such people. May God bless you. Thank you. Thank you.